here to talk about chess and mathematics, how we do problem solving in chess and mathematics. There are many reasons why actually a game of chess can enhance children's mathematical skills. To begin with, board coordinates is an introduction to coordinate systems. There are many mathematical concepts inherently present in chess, such as piece value, 1 for the pawn, 3 for the knight and bishop, 5 for the rook, 9 for the queen. Queening square, the top right diagram. If the black king is inside the queening square, then the king will always catch up with the pawn. Key squares, bottom right diagram. If a white king occupies one of the green fields, one of the key squares, then he can safely guard the pawn to promotion. The binary of nature of the knight is also a mathematical concept in chess. From a dark square, it always takes an even number of moves for a knight to move to another dark square. You are not allowed to waste time with the knight. You cannot lose tempo, and you cannot gain tempo either. There is also mathematical thinking in chess. Logical reasoning is prevalent there. Lots of if and then type of statements. If I don't castle early, then my king might get into trouble, and so on. Metacognition, thinking about thinking. The all too familiar, what have I done? Why did I make this move? We're doing a lot of thinking about our own thinking in chess. So if in your school children play chess, they already do an awful lot of great mathematics. But we can do even more with chess. We can even do some chess and maths. But what is it that I mean by chess and maths? It's a collection of mathematical problems and games that use the chessboard and the chess pieces as their medium. So let me show you some examples. The knight's tour. The exercise is to cover every single square with the knight, but not visiting a square more than once. The diagram on the left represents one of the oldest knight's tours. This is from 840 in Persia, and completed by an avid chess player called Al-Adli Al-Rumi. The one on the right is the so-called diamond method. That's a more recent knight's tour. I use it with primary age children. You scatter 4 different colored diamonds on the board, and then you pick them off color by color to complete the knight's tour. By the way, there are more knight's tours on the chessboard than the estimated number of galaxies in the universe. So you can take your pick. The concept of independence, the famous 8-queen problem, how to place 8 queens on the board so that no 2 queens attack one another. You can do the same with bishops. At most, you can have 14 bishops on the board so that no 2 bishops attack each other. All these arrangements are around the edge of the board. Worst placed army. Chess players know how not to place their pieces. This is the worst possible arrangement. You are attacking altogether 8 squares. And suddenly, this famous position, or infamous position, can be turned into a chess mess exercise for the children. The smileys represent the squares which are not under attack, and the task is to figure out which piece hides behind which flag. Of course, you can turn things around and look for the best placed army, and that is the best placed army in chess. You cannot do better than that. You're only missing out on 7 squares. You're controlling all the rest with this arrangement of the 6 pieces. And here it is as a chess and maths exercise for the children. There are many strategy games you can play. That's one of my favorites, the sliding rooks. We practiced that today in the chess and maths games session. The rooks move horizontally towards each other. They are not allowed to move back. They can't capture each other. They cannot jump over each other. And the person who makes the last move wins the game. A somewhat easier game is the knight race. You're scattering candies or gemstones on the board. They're all worth different number of points, or there are different number of candies inside. Players take turn to move their knights, and the task is to collect as many points as possible. Whoever collects the most number of points wins the game. another favorite with younger children. Point value. The balance of truth is a great way to introduce point value or practice it. The task is to figure out which counter represents which pieces. Of course, the same counters represent the same pieces. And there is the solution on the right. You can also play Sudoku on the chessboard, 6x6 Sudoku, because there are six distinct chess pieces. So in each row and each column, you need to have the six distinct chess pieces, and in each 3x2 rectangle, they need to be different as well. Maze is another favorite type of chess maths question. The rook needs to get to h8, and on his way, must collect as many points as possible. If you don't allow the rook to return to the same square twice, then I think in that particular question, the maximum number of points is 10. Okay, this is all too well. There are many more questions I could show you. But let's talk a little bit about why it's actually useful. Why do we like chess and maths in the classroom? Well, first of all, children who already play chess are familiar with the chessboard and they do not feel threatened. They welcome working in chess teams. Game-based learning is, of course, another well-known reason. It provides intrinsic motivation and engagement. Little chess knowledge is required, and that's useful for the teachers, so teachers don't feel threatened. You only really need to know the moves of the pieces and the idea of controlling a square. The aha moment, a sudden insight into a problem, is often present. And these aha moments can change the beliefs and the attitudes of children who cannot do maths or whose parents told them that they couldn't do maths either. That's why their children can't do maths. So it's a great attitude changer, or it can be. And last, but not at all least, problem solving instead of procedural learning. What is procedural learning? It is a set method to accomplish a task. And what's wrong with teaching mathematics with procedural learning? Well, a slight variation in the problem and the children panic. They throw their hands up. Miss, you never told us how to do this question. We don't know how to do this question because you never told us. So immediately put the blame on the teacher. In problem solving, which is what we use in chess and maths, you do not do that. You do not blame the teacher. You take charge of your own thinking. You do not ask someone else to think for you. If I am thirsty, I don't ask someone else to drink for me. So I shouldn't ask someone else to think for me either. Yeah, that's what we need to teach, really. So think problems, not solutions. Do not give recipes to students. Do not try and fix their thinking. And of course, they need a lot of guidance in how to do problem solving. But luckily, we have some problem solving strategies in mathematics to help us with that. These are the main problem solving strategies. First of all, understand the problem. Don't start it until you understood it. Have you solved a similar problem before? Find an easier problem to solve first. Work backwards from the solution. Use trial and error, and then backtrack to the last step where you went wrong. Sometimes it's enough just to follow the rule. It helps to put information into a table in certain questions. Or work with the opposite. Assume the opposite is true, and then if you come to some contradiction, then you have proved your problem. So I would like to show you just one example for these problem-solving strategies in action. And this is a little story about the inquisitive rook. Of course, storytelling isn't really a problem-solving method, but it's a great way to engage students. So let's go. On one lazy Sunday, with no chess game in sight, the inquisitive rook became very restless and decided to go on a leisurely walk around the chessboard, starting from his home square. His goal, being very curious by nature, was to visit every square of the chessboard and thus reach its furthest corner, the remote H8 square. He did not, however, wish to see any square more than once. These are his first two attempts. the first walk. He left out 7 squares from g2 to g8. His second walk was an improvement, but he still left out a single square on g8. Somehow he couldn't go there. He wasn't called the inquisitive rook for no reason. He decided to investigate this problem on smaller boards. He was shocked to find to fail on a simple 2x2 square already. He couldn't do it, but gathered back up some confidence by easily completing the 3x3 board. Then again, he had no luck with the 4x4 board. He could not go to a single square there. Somehow that was left out. But the 5x5 board was a success again. It looks like boards with even sides are impossible to traverse. I think I need some help to figure out why, said the inquisitive rook thoughtfully. And here comes the help, and the help is baby rook. Let's see how she can help. Baby rook takes one small step in every move to a neighboring square, left, right, up, or down. So just one small step. Every odd move, the first, the third, or the fifth, seventh, is to a light square. You can see it's in red, marked by a red arrow. It always leads to a white light square. Every even move of baby rook, the second, fourth, sixth, and so on, is always to a dark square marked by a blue arrow. So if the baby rook wants to get to h8, then she has to take altogether 63 steps. 63 is an odd number, so it will have to go to a light square. Unfortunately, h8 is a dark square, so it won't be possible. Hence, baby rook cannot complete the tour, and if she can't do it, then neither can the inquisitive rook. So what type of problem-solving methods did we use here? Well, we looked at a simpler problem first. We looked at smaller boards. We even used a simpler piece. We used the baby rook instead of the inquisitive rook. We used lots of trial and error. Tried the tour many times, tried to improve. And baby rook also used assuming the opposite. She was very optimistic. She thought she could do the tour. And then, only after realizing that the 63rd step would take her to a light square, then she realized it's not possible, and therefore the opposite statement was true, the tour is not possible. Okay, so that's it from me. Think problems, not solutions. Thank you for listening.
Thanks a lot, Rita.
Thank you, Leandro.
I found it extremely interesting and very important as well. Now, coming to questions, I guess that the main one that most of our listeners can be asking for is what age group chess and maths exercises are good for?
That's a very easy one to answer. It's 6 to 99, would be my approximation. On a more serious note, any age group of school-age children. Of course, not always the same exercises. There are some more suitable for older ones, more older children for more complex investigations. But there are many of these chess and maths exercises can be tailored for a younger audience by using so-called simplification techniques. You can part solve it. You can do it on a smaller board. There are many ways to make it accessible for younger children. And that is the rich variety of chess that lets us do that.
Mm-hmm. And now for your last couple of minutes, I have a proposal for you.
Okay.
I am asking you to talk to the school math teachers and to summarize why chess can be a very good professional tool for them.
Well, you are a mathematics teacher, so your primary aim is to teach mathematics, and you can do an awful lot of mathematics teaching with chess, and children will be engaged, they will love it, they want to play, so you do not have to motivate them, they will motivate themselves. So that's a big job already done for you by the game of chess. And also they will learn a lot of problem solving, and that will enhance their mathematical skills.
Mm-hmm. You I don't think need 2 minutes. They are fantastic. Oh. You could work very well in the radio as well.
Oh, thank you. I'll try.
Thanks a lot, Rita.
Thank you, Leandro.
Thank you.